Welcome to worship this morning. We have a few announcements to get through. The first I want to note, in our service today, we will have our installation of our council officers. So after our hymn of the day, you are invited to just remain seated through the installation. And I will actually just invite you to remain seated through the creed as well, since right after it we'll be going to the offering. And we'll stand for the prayers. So just a note on that part of the service today. And then a reminder that today we are invited to celebrate with Mary and Zick her 95th birthday at the open house in Gibson City. And when we are done with the announcements, we are going to be singing happy birthday to Dolores for her 94th birthday yesterday. So we'll end our announcements this morning by singing. And then the other announcement that I want to highlight is not actually in your bulletin because I didn't put it in there, but just to put it on your radar, Ash Wednesday is coming up February 22nd. That is a week from this Wednesday. We will have service here at 7 p.m. And next Sunday, I will get the schedule for Lent in the bulletin. It was in the newsletter that went out last week. So just keep that in mind that Lent is coming up. Do we have any other announcements before I turn to our prayer list for this morning? Okay, then I would like you to know for our prayer list today, we have been praying for Tim Whitson for quite some time, but I got a phone call this morning from Viola that he was in a minor accident this morning up by the gas station and was being taken to the hospital just to make sure that he was okay. So as we pray for him this morning, just ask that you pray for him and Viola as they are down at the hospital this morning, making sure that he is okay. And then I also, Kathy let me know that Linda Luce had surgery this past week and is recovering from that. So we add her to our prayer list. And then also Rick and Debbie let me know that Jim Lee died this past weekend. So we will be praying for his family as well. Are there any other people to add to our prayer list this morning? All right, then let us end our announcement time by singing happy birthday to Dolores. And I'm going to let Kathy kick that off. There you go. Confession and forgiveness. We worship as always in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Together in our prayer of the day. O God, the strength of all who hope in you,
because we are weak mortals, we accomplish nothing good without you. Help us to see and understand the things we ought to do, and give us grace and power to do them. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Thanks.
The first reading for today is Deuteronomy 30, 15 through 20. Moses said to the people, "See, I have set before you today life and prosperity, death, and adversity. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I am commanding you today, by loving the Lord your God, walking in his ways, and observing his commandments, decrees, and ordinances, then you shall live and become numerous, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away, and you do not hear, but are led astray to bow down to other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall perish. You shall not live long in the land you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live. Loving God, loving the Lord your God, obeying him, and holding fast to him, for that means life to you and length of days, so that you may live in the land that the Lord swore to give to your ancestors, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob.
Well, this song we're going to do does not quite go with the sermon today, but we really like it. So,
well, it talks about the greatest love. You know, it's being Valentine's Day.
You tell them. She says it's because it's coming up Valentine's Day, and so this is the greatest love that was given.
Love's greatest
The psalm for today we'll read responsively, Psalm 119, 1 through 8. Happy are they whose way is blameless, who follow the teaching of the Lord.
Happy are they who observe your decrees and seek you with all their hearts.
Who never do any wrong, but always talk your ways.
You lay down your commandments that they should fully keep them.
Oh, that my ways were made so direct that I might keep your statutes. I will thank you with a true heart when I have learned your righteous judgments.
I will keep your statutes. Do not utterly forsake me.
Second reading for today is 1 Corinthians 3, 1 through 9. Brothers and sisters, I could not speak to you as a spiritual people, but rather as people of the flesh, as infants in Christ. I fed you with milk, not solid food, for you were not ready for solid food. Even now you are not ready. You are still not ready, for you are still of the flesh. For as long as there is jealousy and quarreling around you, are you not of the flesh, and behaving according to human inclinations? For when one says, I belong to Paul, and another, I belong to Apollos, are you not merely human? What then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants through whom you came to believe as the Lord assigned to each. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. The one who plants and the one who waters have a common purpose, and each will receive wages according to the labor of each. For we are God's servants, working together. You are God's field, God's building. Here ends today's reading.
I invite the young people. No? Okay, well, so we're still going to do the children's sermon because it ties into my sermon. But, and I'm going to ask Isaiah to help me, even though he's taller than I am now, because you and Matt both know this game that we're going to play. So when we were on our multiple long, hour-long car rides down to grandparents and stuff, we used to play a game that was a yes and no game, right? You guys, a lot of you grew up playing like 20 questions kind of stuff. We didn't limit it to that, but what we did was, in our heads, whoever was in charge would pick out an animal, okay? And then the other people in the car could only ask yes and no questions to try to determine what the animal was. So I'm going to pick a pretty simple animal because we don't want to play this for forever, but you're only allowed to ask me yes or no questions. All right, so Isaiah, I'm going to let you start with the first question.
Is it small?
Is it small? No. Anybody else?
Is it green?
Wait, Debbie.
Does it have four legs?
Does it have four legs? Yes.
Is it green?
Is it green? No. Skylar. Huh? Is it an elephant? No. Jameson, do I see your hand? Is it really big? Sometimes. Mark.
Does it have fur?
Does it have fur? Yes.
Does it have a tail?
Sort of. Cherry. Is it a cat? No.
Got it.
Is it a bear? It is a bear! Woo! Right? So, if we were in the car, you would get to pick the next animal, right? And we would go round and round, and it was the interesting thing about it is, as you noticed, I said you can ask me only yes or no questions, and then I answer things like, sometimes, or sort of. Right, so we're going to talk much more in the sermon about the idea of the fact that in the gospel Jesus talks about let your word be yes, yes, or no, no, and how tricky it is sometimes to have a yes or a no answer. So with that in mind, we'll move into the gospel and the sermon. Chapter of St. Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to the disciples, "You have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, 'You shall not murder, and whoever murders shall be liable to judgment.' But I say to you that if you are angry with a brother or a sister, you will be liable to judgment. And if you insult a brother or sister, you will be liable to the council. And if you say, 'You fool,' you will be liable to the hell of fire. So when you are offering your gift at the altar, if you remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother or sister, and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you are on the way to court with him. Or your accuser may hand you over to the judge, and the judge to the guard, and you will be thrown into prison. Truly I tell you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny. You have heard that it was said, 'You shall not commit adultery.' But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to go into hell. It was also said, 'Whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce.' But I say to you that anyone who divorces his wife, except on the ground of unchastity, causes her to commit adultery. And whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Again, you have heard it said that to those of ancient times, 'You shall not swear falsely, but carry out the vows you have made to the Lord.' But I say to you, do not swear at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or by the earth, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. And do not swear by your head, for you cannot make one hair white or black. Let your word be yes, yes, or no, no. Anything more than this comes from the evil one." This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
You may be seated. Well, as you can imagine, playing that animal game filled quite a bit of time in the car. And we love to try to think of more and more challenging animals to give clues about. But we also discovered, as you heard, that answers are not always as easy as yes or no. Would you consider a cow as having fur? Or how would you answer the question, "Is your animal brown?" when you have a dog in mind? To be fair, we often let answers like "some of them," or "could be," slide through into our yes and no game. We were not super strict with the only yes or no aspect. But how strict should we be with it when Jesus is talking? And talking about Scripture, and not just Scripture, but the Ten Commandments, the foundation of our behavior and actions and laws as the people of God. And I also find it terribly ironic that Jesus ends this part of the Sermon on the Mount with "let your word be yes, yes, or no, no," after he has systematically pulled apart the clarity of "thou shalt not murder," and replaced it with the muddier version of, "well, don't be angry or false. And if everything is clear as yes, yes, and no, no, then we have way too many eyes and hands still in this room. And if we removed everything that caused us to sin, it would be a bloodbath in here. If yes, yes, and no, no was that easy, then why does faith seem so hard sometimes? Where answers seem more like could be or sometimes. Faith would be so much easier if it was cut and dried, wouldn't it? Life would be so much easier if everything could be answered in yes and no. We may not always like the answer, but it would be an answer. We would not have to live in the questions and the uncertainty. There would be no maybes or might be. For instance, is murder always murder? If you kill in self-defense or times of war? Is it adultery if you only think it but not act on it? Even though we confess every Sunday to our thoughts, words, and deeds. Is there a difference between those little white lies and perjury? Are you breaking the commandment if you are not honoring your parents, even if they are abusive or neglectful? And I don't even want to begin to think about that commandment of taking the Lord's name in vain, because every sporting event might as well be a gateway to hell. Not to mention handling all the daily events that can't be found in Scripture, that Jesus never talked about, or that don't fit into neat boxes or easy answers. How do we deal with ethical questions around science and medicine with a yes, yes, or no, no kind of faith? There is so much we don't understand, so many new things being learned, and I swear I cannot keep up with it all. Can you? I shouldn't have just sworn. Although I didn't swear on a specific place, so maybe I'm okay. Yes? No? Oh, man, I hope this is just Jesus preaching those opposites again. While I wouldn't go as far today as saying Jesus is speaking in exactly opposites, I would say he is challenging the expectations of the people that faith is as simple as a yes or a no. Mainly, I think that because Jesus never gave a simple yes or no answer. Once he was asked, Jesus, should we pay taxes? Could there be an easier yes or no answer? And yet Jesus avoids it and tells the people, well, give to Caesar what is Caesar and God what is God's. Jesus actively goes out of his way to not give the simple answers. There's a reason the parables aren't told with morals, or even the explanations that come with the questions when the disciples say, we don't get what you're talking about, explain it. He doesn't explain it clearly, neatly, simply. There's a reason Jesus tells his disciples that it will take time to understand everything he is speaking about, and why he spends so much time talking about the same things over and over if it was as easy as a yes, yes, or no, no. Jesus is very honest in acknowledging that faith is not easy or simple. That even something seemingly as cut and dried as thou shall not still has challenge within it and requires thought and understanding. It takes work to believe in what you cannot see or fully understand. It's one of the most amazing and frustrating things about Jesus. He is willing to talk about anything and everything, but he is not willing to just give simple answers to any of it. You must think. Use that brain. He invites people into the conversation. He shows them possibilities they may not have thought about or thought about and dismissed. Or he introduces them to people who think a different way. He takes all the reasons people should be excluded from faith, and he turns them into reasons why everyone should be excluded from faith, so that we see we cannot make those cut and dried yes and no, you belong or don't belong, decisions without thought, without understanding, without first standing in the position of being the one judged and knowing forgiveness, and then seeing how to extend it to others. So that while we should all be excluded, somehow through Christ we are all instead included. And that's not always easy or clear to understand, but that is faith. Jesus makes faith hard. I know none of us like the difficulty or the muddiness or the uncertainty. We would all like it to be as simple as yes, yes, or no, no, but that is not faith. That is certainty. And if we are certain in all things, we have no need for God. We have no need for God's guidance, for God's love, or for God's forgiveness. And oh my goodness, do we need God's forgiveness. I really would like to keep my eyes and my hands. Thank you very much. So how do we do it, God? How do we live not knowing the answer to everything we are meant to do or be? Questioning how to handle the tough decisions of this world. Is there anything clear and unquestionable? Yes. Yes. God's love for us. That is unchangeable. That is the foundation for every question, every decision, every discussion, and every uncertainty we face. We cannot live out the commandments the way Jesus talks about them today. Not one of us has lived without an angry feeling toward one another, without some body part getting us into trouble. You may not have a wandering eye, but we have all had wagging tongues and pointed fingers. Every one of us has given an untruthful answer. A, no, I'm busy. When, yes, we could have gone or helped. Or a, yes, absolutely, I can do that. When, no, I actually can't, and I didn't. And God knows that about us. It's not news to him that we're rather incapable of being the people God created us to be. But that doesn't stop God from loving us. Or reminding us time and again to try once more, to listen anew, to love others deeply and have faith in him when the maybes and the could-bes grow too much. God is the one sure answer we have. The yes to the question, can we be forgiven? The no to the question, do I deserve that trauma or tragedy in my life? The yes, yes to the question, are we loved? Yes, yes, eternally, unquestioningly, overwhelmingly, yes, yes, we are loved. Amen. Thank you. conversations going on, we discovered that Murray woke up this morning with a sore throat and is unable to be here. So we are going to move the installation of the officers till next Sunday. So sorry, guys, you have to dress up another Sunday in a row. But so we will eventually get to it. Last week I forgot about it. This week I remembered it. Murray's sick. Let's see what happens next week. No matter what. All right. All right. So if you're not here, well, tune back.
I think it's probably Pastor Matt.
Yes.
Yeah, so unless he forgets.
There you go. There's no guarantees of any of it. So, any rate, so we will go ahead and move on to the Apostles' Creed. I invite you to just go ahead and remain seated, since we'll go right into the offering after that. So let us confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Together to follow Jesus, let us pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Inspire your church that it may be a sign of life throughout the world, from the exploration of faith with children and new believers to the missionaries and bishops. Shape lives of faithfulness so that all may find abundant life in your ways. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Nourish your creation. Accompany all who plant and water. Bless the work of farmers. Guide scientists who seek new ways to feed the world. Grant safety to those affected by recent earthquakes, and watch over those who live in the midst of war. Bring wholeness to this world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Nurture all in need. Bring healing to all who experience trauma caused by systems of injustice or destructive relationships. Give courage to those struggling to repent and those seeking reconciliation. Sustain all who work to heal and give care to others. And bless those who are in need of healing. We remember especially this day Irene, Lee, Marion, Al, Shirley, Lisa, Julia, Marilyn, Don, Heidi, Pastor Lisa, Bonnie, Bill, Bob, Tim, Mason, Dawson, Mike, Sean, Rod, Pat, Joanne, Gary, Sandy, Linda, and the Lee family. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Thanks be to you for the lives of all who have died in Christ. We remember especially this day, Jim. Teach us to follow them in your ways, and gather us with them into the promise of eternal life with you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We bring to you our needs and our hopes, O God, trusting in your wisdom and your power, which was revealed in your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.